thank the speaker again. The next speaker is Yurii Dumin from the Sternberg Institute of Moscow, and his title is "Can the Dark Matter Deficit in the High-Redshift Galaxy Explain the Persistent Discrepancy of the Hubble Constellation?"
Good afternoon. I am going to present a few quite trivial comments about the current situation with determination of the Hubble constant. And I'll try to be short and to leave sufficient time for the questions. So as all of you know, of course, determination of the Hubble parameter remains a long-standing problem in cosmology for almost a century. And for example, the very first estimates of this parameter about 80 or 90 years ago resulted in the values about 500 kilometers per second per megaparsec. And now this our estimates of this value are reduced by almost an order of magnitude. However, despite of considerable improvements in the determination of the Hubble parameter, some discrepancies persist till now. And the most noticeable of them is that the value of Hubble parameter derived from the distance scale based on the cepheids and supernova, and thereby referring to the relatively local scales, is about 73, while the analysis based on the cosmic microwave background radiation under assumption of lambda CDM model and actually corresponding to the much larger scales leads to the values about 67 or something like that. That is about 10% less. So the above-mentioned discrepancy between the local and global values of the Hubble constant is widely discussed now in the literature, and it is usually explained either by the systematic errors, such as degeneracy, between the different quantities in the analysis of CMB, or by uncertainty in the fitting parameters, such as the number and masses of neutrinos or so on, or the very popular explanation just in the recent couple years is the involvement of some non-standard values of the dark energy equation of state parameter W, or the temporal variability of this parameter. However, from my personal point of view, this spread in the values of Hubble constant can have, in principle, a much more simple explanation based just on a slight variation in the average dark matter density throughout the space. Really, As follows from the recent measurements of the rotation curves of distant galaxies at redshifts about 0.6 to 2.6, which were published just in the recent years, in the last year, in fact, the dark matter density in the vicinity of such galaxies is substantially less than in our local neighborhood. Here you see a couple of figures from the papers cited here, and you see that while in our local neighborhood we have the rotation curves with almost flat asymptotics, in the case of such distant galaxies, the rotation curves sharply decay, and this indicates a much less contribution from the dark matter halos. Besides, we should keep in mind that due to the same dust-like equation of state of both the luminous and dark matter, the densities of both these components evolve with time by the same law, and therefore the ratio of their densities remain the same. That is, this cannot be a trivial explanation of the above mentioned problem. Then, if we we can make the trivial estimates, so employing the standard Friedmann equation, where rho dE is the energy density of dark energy, dm dark matter, and lm luminous matter, we can easily find the ratio of the Hubble parameters at the local and global scales, which is written here. Next, if for the sake of illustration we assume that the dark energy is perfectly uniform in space, that is given by the lambda term, the distribution of luminous matter also sufficiently uniform, so that the average densities at various scales are approximately the same. But the average densities of dark matter can vary depending on the scale under consideration. Then we get such kind of the plot. And as you can see here, the 10% increase in the local value of the Hubble parameters compared to the global one, which is marked by the red strip here, can be attributed just to the excessive amount of the dark matter is in our local cosmological neighborhood, which is which could be, for example, two times greater than its global value. Of course, this result evidently not result, but this idea evidently contradicts the frequent claims in the current literature. For example, you heard here the report by Karachinsev and Kosis that we live in the void of dark matter, that is, the local values of the dark matter density should be reduced. However, from my point of view, the analysis of the rotation curves mentioned in the previous slide, referring to the distant galaxies, is a much less model dependent method, and therefore it is much more reliable than the analysis of the local group of galaxies, which is often substantially based on the concept of the so-called antigravity forces. Really, let me clarify what do I actually mean. From my point of view, the main weakness in the analysis of the dynamics of the local group, which we can see in many recent papers, is the employment of the so-called antigravity forces. And therefore, the corresponding estimates of the dynamical masses are substantially dependent on the involvement of such approximation. Namely, what do I mean? Well, what is the weakness? The problem is that while the standard Newtonian forces, inversely proportional to the square root of radii, can be very rigorously derived from the general relativity equations by the so-called Einstein-Infeld-Hofmann method, which was developed in approximately in 1950s or 60s. On the other hand, the antigravity forces, as far as I know, are introduced mostly just intuitively as the counterparts of the usual Newtonian forces, which appear in the Schwarzschild Disseter metric. Namely, as far as I know, there is no rigorous way to derive such a kind of antigravity force, and all arguments which I have seen in the literature are based just on the intuitive association of the corresponding metric components with some kind of effective Newtonian potentials, but no rigorous proof of this fact exists now. From my point of view, the absence of such rigorous mathematical proof is especially important just in the case of when we try to apply them to the multi-body systems. I'm afraid that many calculations of the dynamics of the local group of galaxies based on such kind of forces may be very misleading. And in this sense, the data on the rotation curves of distant galaxies, which are based purely on the well-known Newtonian dynamics with usual gravitational forces, are much more reliable. So let me just summarize the basic points of my report. I believe that measurement of the rotation curves of the distant galaxies provides a much firmer basis for estimating the relative amounts of dark matter in the local and distant universe. So according to such estimates, we live in the overdense rather than in the underdense part of the universe. And just this fact provides a natural explanation why the global values of the Hubble parameter, namely derived from the analysis of CMB, are about 10% less than the local values based on the distance scale derived from the Cepheids and supernovae. Thank you for your attention.
The metric was that you said, this metric was, I'm not sure if it was Tolman or McVitie, but it was derived many, many years ago.
So sorry?
Tolman, R.C. Tolman.
As I know, this metric, actually, it is usually called Schwarzschild-Disseter, but actually, as I know, it was derived by Kotler in 1918. After writing the Einstein equations.
Okay, so I misunderstood you. I saw that you stated it was intuitively put by hand.
I mean when we try to interpret this metric coefficients.
About the interpretation.
Yes. What's your question?
It's okay. You answered my question. Any other questions? Yes, please.
So, from what I understood 2 years ago and this morning again, there is no, there's no evidence one way or the other of dark matter related to Z, to distance. Now, you say something different, which I don't have the need to object, but then, supposing that one takes a different view and sees rotation curves as alternative gravity, although one can imagine that dark matter is depending on distance, small scale or large scale, then it would be extremely difficult to consider a gravitation depending on distance, an alternative theory depending on distance. So that is the main point.
I didn't understand in sufficient detail. Could you repeat probably once again? You mean involvement of some kind of alternative theory of gravitation?
Yes.
No, I don't consider such.
I know, I understand. But so I think one major, let's say, consideration, conclusion for your idea is that indeed you rule out gravity.
I don't rule out, but how to say, I think that they are not so necessary in some sense. From my point of view, it would be more simple to attribute it just to fluctuations in the average densities, averaged over different scales. From my point of view, it's much more trivial and simple explanation, yes. And I believe that just the recent data on the rotation curves of distant galaxies are very, how to say, reliable evidence for that, because such rotation curves are very model independent.
Okay. I understood that there was not so much evidence of dependence or rotation curves on that. But
as I said,
I don't do observations.
I also do not perform any observations, but what is the main point of my trouble is that there are very many papers in the literature on the dynamics of for example, local group of galaxies, which are based on the concept of anti-gravity forces. From my point of view, there is no firm basis for taking the anti-gravity forces. The forces related to the cosmological lambda term, there is no good reason to take them just in this approximation, especially for many body interactions. I didn't see any reasonable proofs, theoretical proofs for using such kind of forces. I suppose that such kind of anti-gravity force may be a reasonable tool, to explain something to students or something like that, but involving them in the accurate calculations, from my point of view, it's hardly reasonable.
More questions, anybody?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, I'm trying to understand intuitively your result, and if you want to increase the local Hubble flow, yes, normally you would assume that we live in underdense region, so that we have super Hubble flow. Yeah,
I don't understand.
Outflow of matter from the center. It's like in a void. Yeah, that's a kind of standard picture. Yes.
No, what do you mean? Yes. So standard picture is that we live in the
yeah,
void.
Yeah. The question is how to make the local Hubble flow larger than the global. Yes.
So you are saying
that you need local omega matter larger than.
No, no. I employ quite trivial and well known cosmological equation, just the Friedman equation for the value of Hubble constant in terms of the various contributions from the various components of the energy density. And in the case where if you have a locally the large amount of energy density due to any component, you have just the larger value of Hubble constant. Hubble parameter is just the trivial, my trivial idea.
Yeah, but if you consider Friedman equation locally, shouldn't you use Bukert equation? You have additional term, Bukert equation.
I don't know what is Bukert.
So you have additional term, from the fact that you consider, a finite volume, a small volume.
Well, I'm not familiar with that. I'm afraid I'm not familiar with it.
We can follow up.
Maybe. Because this equation is a global one,
right,
for the whole universe.
Yeah. Strictly speaking, it's global, but I assume
can
that
for locally?
Sufficiently large scale of averaging, it can be applied. Of course, strictly speaking, it's global, but I suppose that interpolation of this equation to not so large scales, like, for example, related to such redshift about one, something like that. It's more reasonable interpolation than as compared to introduction of anti-gravity forces in so simple way as they are commonly used.
We should move on. Send the